and welcome to the January 18th, 1994 Planning Board meeting of Cape Elizabeth. First order of business are the minutes of the previous meeting. We do have the last page of the prior month's minutes, which we were missing at the time. We did, however, make changes to that. Are there any other changes or corrections that each board member didn't have a copy last time, if you remember? We made some quick changes at the time. Thank you for submitting that, Alice. Also, next we have the December 21, 1993 minutes of the Planning Board meeting. Any comments, corrections, changes? Mark? Don? Steve? No. See if I had any.
Did you say December 1st, 1993?
I might have.
You're talking about the current...
December 21st.
Okay. Yes, on page 5.
Okay.
Paragraph 1, 2, 3. I just want to be clear on the course of events during that disruption as to what, excuse me, as to whether or not there was a 3-2 vote in favor prior to or after Mr. Malia Jr. asked to speak and said their withdrawal is withdrawn.
Sure.
Well, as I remember it, he asked to speak and wasn't allowed to speak until afterward. Isn't that the way it was?
And we did actually vote in favor of it? Even
yes, we went ahead and voted, and then I returned to the podium and asked him if he had any word to speak, and then he reversed their their withdrawal. Is that okay, the chronology as it stands?
That's fine.
Okay. I have just a comment on page 5, second paragraph. Mr. Dressel reminded him that he was speaking out of turn, not out of place, I think. Question back on page 4, last paragraph, first sentence. Mr. Emery responded that the first rule of working with plans is you don't scale a plan. Is that worded correctly, Tom?
That's close enough.
Okay. Bottom of 4, but Tom said that's fine. Let's see if I have any other changes. Excellent job, Alice. Anything else? Do I hear a motion? Judy?
I propose we accept the minutes of December 21st, 1993 as corrected.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? Unanimous vote. Thank you, Alice, very much. Next, the correspondence received during the past month. We have the minutes of the meeting of the Cape Elizabeth School Building Committee from December 21st. And I've said before, I appreciate the school committee keeping us up to date with their progress. Next, a letter from the DEP from Dean Marriott, signed by Deb Richard, referencing the approval of the zoning ordinance amendments. Anything special we should know about that, Maureen? Other than it's just official notification?
Because those amendments relate to shoreline zoning, any amendment has to be approved by DEP.
Very good. On an article from the Townsman in reference street naming, I'm sorry I did not read that, but I'll put it on top of my list to read as soon as I get home tonight. Next, the...
I would just like to comment, thank you for enclosing that, because I've been involved in more than one review where there's been lengthy discussion as to how this is to happen. This is very logical and I think easy to understand.
I didn't mean to make fun of
no, I know.
The subject matter itself. I've been in those discussions as well. January 6, 1994, Cape Elizabeth School Building Committee references our workshop that we held with them. Next, a memo from Michelle Flynn to all the planning board members, just summarizing the actions taken during the year. I think we did pretty well. It's almost two per meeting as far as approvals. I think that's a pretty healthy sum of work to get through. Next, a letter from town attorney in reference to the Drynan public access waiver from signed by Michael Hill. From Monahan Leahy might want to put that back in your drawing packet for that agenda item. Lastly, two items on the, or three things on the podium tonight. One, a letter to myself from Michael McGovern in reference to budgeting issues, dealing with requests for any activity. I'll try to take care of that issue. Next, a memo on the podium tonight from Phil McGoldrick, the fire chief, to Maureen, in reference to the Drynan public access waiver. That, too, you might take a quick read. Down through that and put it with your Drynan packet. We always appreciate when the public works members, fire chief, police chief, public works, can put their comments to us in writing. Lastly, and actually not on the podium tonight, but as Maureen always supplies us with a tentative planning board schedule, it looks like we have a pretty busy spring coming up. Maureen?
I just want to call attention to the meeting on your tentative schedule for the 24th. The council is holding a workshop, and the first half hour of that workshop will be a presentation from our consultants on the Town Center Stormwater Plan, which is in a preliminary form. Board members are also invited to attend that meeting.
Do you know what time it is?
I
they usually meet at...
I believe it's at 7:30.
Very good. Also of note, Tom Emery and I will be attending tomorrow night, as a reminder, Tom. I don't remember what time it is. 7 o'clock, I assume,
o'clock.
In the cafeteria land use process review, land use regulation process review committee. Doesn't quite have a jingle to the acronym, but it will someday. Any other correspondence from the board? Okay, moving on to new business. The first order of business tonight, Bluestone Corporation Earth Materials Removal Permit, request by L.P. Murray for annual renewal of the Earth Materials Removal Permit for the Bluestone Quarry located at 1019 Sawyer Road, public hearing, section 19-3-8. If the applicant, Mr. Murray, could come to the podium. This is an annual event, and instead of going through the entire application, you might just summarize what you have before us, especially if there are any changes from the prior year.
Okay. My name is Jim Murray. I'm the president of Bluestone Corporation, located at 1019 Sawyer Street. Nothing has changed. I have updated the abutters. Some new abutters there. I've updated that. The request of Maureen. And otherwise than that, it pretty much remains the same as it did last year.
Very good.
To my knowledge, there's been no complaints. So.
Okay. Very good. Maureen seconds that. I think it does require that we have a public hearing, and before we get into board discussion, I think I'll open up a public hearing. This time I officially open this agenda item for public hearing. Any members of the public wish to speak to address the board in reference to this agenda item? Seeing and hearing none, I now close the public hearing. Any discussion by the board? Judy?
This is for the town planner, and it's I'm sure verbatim of a question one of us asked last year. When we go through the proposed motion, there's a list of proposed conditions on page 3. And in item 3, it mentions the applicant. Item 7, it mentions the corporation. And item 8, it mentions Leland Murray. And I don't remember why the answer was last year that they were all different or why they haven't been made to agree.
There's no reason why they couldn't all be compatible. They're just not consistent right now.
Okay. The other question I had is on item number 6. It talks about, it says, no machinery or equipment shall be operated before 9 a.m. or after 6 p.m. on any day, except that loading of trucks may take place between 7:30 a.m. and 4:30 p.m. Mr. Murray, is that the only time you can load trucks is between 7:30 and 4:30 p.m.?
Yep.
Okay, just so it reads better for next year, I suggest that the may be taken out and trucks shall only take place. But I have no concerns or questions about it otherwise.
Any other comment? Questions? Motion? They're all pointing at each other because it's a long motion to read.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Judy.
I propose the following motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact, one, the applicant operates Bluestone Quarry located at 1019 Sawyer Road. Two, this facility requires a special permit to remove earth materials under section 19-3-8. Three, the facility will conduct blasting and transport operations which could endanger the public health, safety, and welfare. Four, the applicant has substantially addressed the requirements needed for issuance of a special permit for removal of earth materials. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Leland Murray for a special permit for removal of earth materials at the Bluestone Quarry located at 1019 Sawyer Road be granted by the Planning Board for a one-year period beginning January 19, 1994 and ending with the regular January 1995 meeting of the Planning Board, subject to the following conditions. One, the applicant shall keep accurate records of any and all blasting operations, including times and dates of such operations and information on size and placement of all charges. Two, all blasting shall be performed by or under the direct personal supervision of a person qualified, experienced, and regularly engaged in such work and shall be done in a manner which will not endanger the health or safety of any person or damage any real or personal property on or off the quarry site. Representatives of the applicant shall be present at the time of the blasting operation. Three, the applicant shall maintain comprehensive general public liability insurance with coverage not less than $500,000 per person and per occurrence for bodily injury or death, and not less than $100,000 per occurrence for property damage. Four, the schedule for any blasting and drilling shall be submitted by the applicant to the building inspector at least 7 days prior to the commencement of work. The schedule shall include the name of the drilling and or blasting subcontractor who will perform the work and a certificate of insurance for such subcontracting. The schedule shall be approved by the building inspector prior to the commencement of the work. Drilling and blasting shall be scheduled for no more than one half day at a time. Five, no operations shall be conducted at the quarry on Saturdays, Sundays, or holidays, except that stone may be loaded and trucked from the site on Saturdays. Six, no machinery or equipment shall be operated before 9 a.m. or after 6 p.m. on any day, except that loading of trucks shall only take place between 7:30 a.m. and 4:30 p.m. Fencing and appropriate signs shall be maintained. The applicant shall maintain at least 12 signs, three on each side of the property, reading "Danger, no trespassing." Eight, the applicant shall make a reasonable attempt to notify Cape Elizabeth residents along Sawyer Road and Stillman Street in the vicinity of the quarry prior to any blasting operation. Nine, no more than 10,000 cubic yards of material shall be removed during the term of this permit. 10, if the building inspector finds at any time that the health, safety, or welfare of area residents or property is threatened by quarry operations, he or she is authorized and directed to order that all work at the site be suspended immediately and to require that operations be resumed only after further action by the Planning Board.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion, Tom?
Yes, I have just a couple of questions. Who's crazy enough not to vote for this? Is the first question.
Is that your first question?
Well, this is the third year that Jim's been before the board, and I haven't seen anyone raise any objections yet. So I just—it's just too tempting to vote against it. And see what happens. On a serious note, where does the requirement for 12 signs come from? Is that something that's been worked out in mutual agreement?
That's under the town's earth materials removal permit requirements.
Is that within any regular distance, or is it, if it's a 300 miles, you put up three signs?
Per side.
Okay. And have you consistently notified abutters, and how do you do that?
No, we do it by knocking on the doors, and we do it by air horn, okay, prior to the blast. Each blast.
Are you required to do any photographic records of the...
I do, if I feel there's going to be a problem.
On a time-to-time basis?
Yeah.
Okay. No, other than that, I have no questions.
Anything further?
No.
Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's unanimous. See you next year. And I think Jim's probably been here much more than 3 years.
That's up to 3 years that I've been.
Next order of business this evening, the Drynan Public Access Waiver Request by Edward Drynan for a public access waiver of three lots located in the vicinity of 367 Mitchell Road, Public Access Waiver Section 19-2-4B. The applicant and any other representatives of the applicant, please come to the podium, identify yourself, and if you could give us a brief summary, specifically of any other new changes. The applicant was before our workshop session in December, I believe it was. Give us a brief summary.
I'm Edward Drynan. I'm here to propose a public access waiver to service three lots at my property, which is 18.7 acres, located at 367 Mitchell Road. Rather than recite all of the information I've submitted to you, I will take your suggestion and highlight those things that we have done as a result of the workshop. With me tonight is David Camillo, Principal Engineer at Land Use Consultants, who will specifically address some of the issues. The first one I'll mention is the pavement radius where the driveway meets Mitchell Road, a pavement radius of 16 feet. I've noted that the fire chief is in agreement with that, and I'd like to point out that even with a 16-foot radius, it ends up with 50 feet of pavement as it meets the pavement at Mitchell Road. It's quite wide, and I didn't want to have such an obtrusive or more obtrusive entryway to the three house lots back there. 16 feet seems to be adequate, and I would like it to stay that way. The site distance, Cape Elizabeth Police Department Officer Von Dyer visited the site and recommended that certain trees be removed. I have and will agree to remove all that you order removed. However, I feel that it is not conducive to the ambiance of Mitchell Road with its mature trees close to roadside to remove some of them. At this particular location, one is a particularly mature twin oak tree. Each of the forks in it are in excess of 12 inches in diameter. I think that the removal of some of the scrub brush will be adequate. I'd like to point out that the driveway, as it exists today, has been used for more than 40 years. There was a question at our workshop regarding soil suitability, HHE 200s. The septic system designs have been submitted. David Camillo will comment on the town code enforcement officer's comment regarding their location and the suitability of building envelope sizes. Adequate access by municipal emergency vehicles. Today I talked with the fire chief, and after having met with him in early December, there was apparently some confusion, and I did go over that with him. It was my intent, as you know, to create two new lots. I think he thought I said two lots, period, the existing lot plus a new lot. In any event, I've noted his recommendation to you for a wider access point. I'm assuming that's 18 feet versus 16 feet at Mitchell Road. I also noted his observance when he went there a few days ago, and when it was not adequately plowed. I'd like to point out that there are tenants at that property, and I just yesterday took over the snow plowing responsibility after visiting them and pointing out to them that their efforts to maintain the driveway in an adequate fashion were not being done very well. And I could understand the chief's concern as he witnessed the driveway as it existed a few days ago. You also have in your package, as a result of our workshop, draft deeds for the three properties. There is a very minor discrepancy in all of those deeds. I've discussed it with my attorney, and so minor that it's and so easily correct that I won't go into detail on that. I've also submitted, and it has met with the town attorney's approval, language in all of the deeds regarding access and maintenance for the lots. I've also submitted, and it's met with the town attorney's approval, the creation of the three lots not being a subdivision. If you'd like, Dave Camillo will comment on the existing road width. I noted that the town engineer said that the existing road width as scaled on the diagram appears to be 6 or 7 feet. David Camillo will tell you that when that driveway was put on the survey for me some years ago, the center line was accurate and the sidelines were etched in. The existing driveway is and always has been 12 feet wide. He will also comment on site distance. He will comment on an existing turnaround, if you would like, which now exists. It's at least 50 by 60 feet paved at the end of the driveway. And the septic system location size and building window size. I'd like to comment, before he does that, on the fire chief's desire for a turnaround to service the two new lots. And I will point out that there will be driveways from the right-of-way into the two lots. Those driveways will be opposite one another, and it will not be difficult, and I don't object to, making a vehicle turnaround there at the intersection of the two new driveways servicing lots 2 and 3. So I think I can comply with the fire chief's request in that regard. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dryan. I guess I'll ask the board if they have any if they'd like to have Camilla, I'm sorry. Any comments from him referencing the road?
Okay. No.
This application does not require that we find the application complete. It's a public access waiver. The issue of public hearing, site walks, and so forth are at the wishes of the board. I think what I'd like to do probably is just start some general concession. I know one of your abutters is here, maybe more. Then we'll see whether a public hearing is in need at that time. I'd like to just open up for general discussion and comments and questions from the board, please. Tom?
Yes, I just have a couple of questions. The first question is, at Mitchell Road, there's an existing right-of-way that accesses your brother's property, is it?
Yes.
Are you proposing to abandon that as part of the new 50-foot right-of-way? What you end up with, at least in the detail plan, is one right-of-way to the rear lots, which is actually within Lot 3, overlapping the existing right-of-way. Seems this is an opportunity that if you're doing a developing or relotting the parcel is to clean all of the lines up and make it nice and neat and orderly, so to speak, with the new deeds. And it's just, to me, it's very confusing. That's my first question. The second question is, and I guess I'll leave this up to both you and your consultant, is on why is the right-of-way within Lot 3 when, in fact, Lot 1 is the largest parcel and the one farthest back that would seem to be me to be the most in need of access, so to speak? The other last question I would have is, in looking at the building envelopes on Lot 2, would you just discuss briefly for the board why the envelope is measured at 95 feet, or scaled at 95 feet wide, rather than setback from a property line?
I'll answer those now.
Yes, that's it.
The right-of-way, the first right-of-way that you mentioned to my brother Michael's property has been in existence, if I can give some background, if you were to draw straight lines from this property out to Mitchell Road, you will then have historically what was the Harriman property. He was a blacksmith, he lived here at what is now 359 Mitchell Road, where Mr. Newell, who is here tonight, lives. And over the years, particularly following World War II through the mid-50s, the Harrimans cut out a lot to the abutters who are now Potter, to a son of theirs, a lot to what is now Michael Drynan, who was a son of the Harrimans, and a smaller lot to what is now the Mullen property. At that time, they established this right-of-way, which you first mentioned, which served one of the Harriman children. After I bought the property, which at that, when I purchased it, it included what is now the Newell property and the rest of the land, I allowed Mr. Harriman to have access down the driveway and in to the front of his house, rather than driving across the front of his lawn. I gave him access over my property. I spoke to my lawyer at that time about removing this from the deed. He said it was a very difficult thing to do, since this right-of-way appears in other deeds, other than mine. And he suggested leaving it there, leaving it in place. That's the only answer I can give you. It's been discussed, and he thought it was a difficult thing to do. Regarding your question, why the 50-foot accessway runs in fee with Lot 3? The answer to that is very simple. I'm hoping you've had a chance since our workshop to visit the site.
I did drive out.
We've laid this out in a particular way, which I want it to be amenable to all three parties who will live here. And basically, you'll note the notch in the property of Lot 1, the main lot. That notch is there so that anybody who drives down this private driveway can, from the outset, see that there is an end to it. They will see two driveways going to Lot 2 and 3, but it will be clearly marked here, that's the purpose of the notch, fencing, a slight realignment of existing fencing to say that this is a private property back here. That's why the notch was put there. And the driving factor for the lot lines were that of Lot Number 2, keeping it on this side of the existing driveway, and it came out to be that big. Once that was done, we just ran as best we could a natural dividing line, as you see depicted. And that caused this right-of-way to be owned by this Lot 3. It's just a natural layout of the land, driven by the size of Lot 3, and a desire to have a clean a line as possible, separating the two smaller lots from the larger rear lot.
Just to follow up on that, the original, or the, as it's labeled, existing right-of-way, is that required for physical access to any of these properties at this time? Does it? It shows an existing gravel drive on the plan. If the driveway is realigned as shown on the plans, what happens to that existing?
That doesn't exist anymore. That, where it says existing drive, does not exist. Where it says gravel drive, the little tiny narrow drive, does not exist. The entire piece down here is graveled and firm. There is a legal right-of-way that runs as depicted, but the gravel driveway that Mr. Harriman used to use to access his property, which caused him to drive across his front yard, doesn't exist anymore, because I allowed him to drive on my driveway and into the front of his house.
And just lastly, regardless of, excuse me, the width of the proposed paved road, is there any consideration for a taper between the 12-foot wide paved area and then down to the narrower section, as at least delineated in the 1 inch equals 20 scale detail plan?
I'm sorry, is there any consideration for what?
For a taper of the gravel driveway so that its edges are flush with the paved section. As you come, if you
yes.
enter, you go suddenly from a 12-foot wide gravel driveway to something at least that's depicted narrower than that.
Yeah. The existing gravel driveway is 12 feet as it stands today, even though the town engineer commented that when he looked at the plan, it was reflected when he scaled it at 6 or 7 feet. It has always been 12 feet.
So those lines just need to be moved out?
Yes. And there will be no noticeable transition from pavement to gravel other than the straight line at the end of the pavement.
Mm-hmm.
There will be gravel on both sides of the pavement, which will exceed the 12 feet, and that will slowly taper to at least 12 feet for the rest of the run.
Okay. Jar my memory one more time. With the alignment of the issue with the overall width of the driveway at Mitchell Road, the one of the issues, or one, something that really aggravates or causes that to be wider than necessary, is the fact that you're meeting Mitchell Road at an acute angle, at least
yes.
On the northbound side.
Yes.
If you were to realign that and move the entrance farther north, does that gets into all the trees, and what else is in that area? That
well, it gets into trees. There's the underground water line there. There's a
Is there any ledge?
Maybe a 3-foot elevation in land. There are a lot of trees planted there. The existing gravel opening within that right-of-way is quite wide today.
Mm-hmm. I only mentioned it in that you mentioned that even with a 16-foot radius, you still ended up with a 50-foot wide paved entrance to the driveway, and I was just...
I was
wondering out loud
if
there were a way of making it narrower, if you wish to do so.
I'd like to.
That's all.
Other comments, board members?
Oh, excuse me. You didn't answer, or at least I didn't understand your answer, regarding the width of the building area on Lot 2. Is that in response to a wetland setback line?
No, it isn't. The width of the building... I have a particular house in mind which I'm trying to get or convince my brother would be a good house for him to build. And it's a 95-foot building window would be sufficient.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when I gave you that, I said, do this 95 feet wide here. And I never thought about why the building window is depicted as not referenced from setbacks, but rather within itself is 95 feet. That's my sketch plan that I gave to the engineers.
Would it be correct to assume that if this were recorded in the way in which it's drawn, we would not expect to go out on the site and find the house outside that building envelope?
I believe that if the applicant tried to get a building permit outside the building envelope, that the code officer would not issue it.
So it seemed that you'd want to expand that envelope to whatever the buildable area is within that lot.
I'm not sure I follow the drift here.
If you look at Lot 3, you've used
yes,
rear yard and side yard and front yard setbacks to define the building envelope.
Yes.
And when you go in to locate a building on that site, you can do it anywhere within those setbacks.
Yes.
On Lot 2, you have a front, rear, and side yard, but then on the side closest to Lot 1, you have some unknown setback there. And the only way that the window is defined is by saying that the buildable window is 95 feet wide, which floats in space. If you
end
up with a house that needs 110 feet, I just want to save you another trip back here. I don't know if that's how that would have to happen, but I would suggest that you look, I'm not telling you where to put the line, but just look more closely at that if you need more flexibility on that lot.
Okay. I interpret this as it now reads to be the westernmost edge of that building window to be 30 feet plus 95 feet from the northern boundary. That's the maximum it could be.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what we're talking about?
Yes. Okay. My point is that you might want it to be 100, maybe 102, 108. And if there's something on the face of the earth, like a wetland setback or some other criteria that sets that line that might be give you more flexibility in locating the house, perhaps you'd want to do that rather than find yourself either on the site or with a code enforcement officer needing another building footprint. I just leave that up to you. That's
I see. Yes, I understand. Thank you.
No other questions.
Okay. Other comments from the board? Judy?
This is one of those applications I have a hard time discussing tonight because I really see it needing to come back. One, I would be interested in a site walk if we're talking about driveway locations being, I would guess, specified on the plan if there's even a thought that that could be used as a turnaround, but I thought there was something in the ordinance that prohibited turnarounds being driveways. Do you know, Maureen? There is a prohibition?
Yes, there is a prohibition. So, there is a provision that prohibits that.
Okay, so that would have to be figured out. I'm very curious as to what vegetation is that would need to be cut down, or Mr. Drinan would prefer not to cut down. It's not clear to me on the septic location of Lot 3 whether there is an adequate area for both septic and house. A lot of the engineers' comments trouble me, having not seen them addressed yet. I think they can be addressed. And I, for one, since I understand there's at least one abutter interested in this, I would be interested in a public hearing.
I think I'll open up this time. I see Chris Noel here. And just by show of hand, would you be interested in speaking in a public hearing if we should have one, if we should schedule one? Okay. We have one abutter that would be interested in. I don't open that up for public comment tonight because if I do that, then I automatically have to schedule one. I'm obligated to schedule one for a month from now because I've opened it up on unannounced. Other board members interested in the public hearing? I think we'll schedule a public hearing, which would require that we come back another month, another meeting from now. We do have an abutter who would like to speak. So at this point, I'd like to schedule, make sure that we schedule that. So I think as we proceed with this application, I'd like to see that we give the applicant as much guidance, as much direction as we can, saying when to prevent having to come back more than once. In other words, come back with a clean plan next month, have a public hearing, and see what happens from that point. The public hearing may open up additional issues. I guess I'll return to the board for more comment. Judy?
Once again, I'll say how these public access waivers trouble me. In essence, this is a subdivision, but because of ownership, it's not a subdivision. But our review standards, if they have any merit for subdivision review, you would think they would have merit in this case. And the thought that we are often asked and sometimes do act on basically, in essence, subdivisions that we've never seen and plans needing major amounts of revision, I feel very uncomfortable with that, and I hope at one point we will review and revise the public access waiver standards because we keep creating all these little lots.
We do, and that was one reason I asked to have a full record of the last 3 years' worth of public access waivers, just to see the numbers that we've actually, I think it's 28 public access waiver approvals that we went through in the last 3 years, and so it's cumulatively, it's we're dealing with the numbers of small or minor subdivisions, in essence. Go ahead, Judy. Sorry.
I just would hope, Mr. Drinan, that you can revise your plans to get rid of the discrepancies in the driveway width. When we look at our plans, it shows a driveway width proposed of 12 feet, and then the existing drive, which is not shown as 12 feet. Things like that need to be cleared up. We need more thought needs to be given to the turnaround, and that can be done probably in consultation with the fire chief. And as Mr. Emery said, if there's any possibility, perhaps reorienting the entrance onto Mitchell Road So to get the pavement width down, I certainly would support that. I wouldn't mind seeing the proposed septic locations on the two lots if that can be put on. I guess it could be. You've done the test pits. And I'd still like a sidewalk, but with this much snow, I don't know if that's going to be helpful or not.
Okay. Ed, I'm looking for consensus from the board as far as the sidewalk. Other members interested in the sidewalk?
I think in terms of discussing the trees that need to be cleared, it would be helpful. And I would suggest the applicant should somehow either tape or flag the trees that you'd like to save.
I'd say
Whichever is less.
I've flagged the trees which Officer Dyer recommended removing.
Okay.
I would suggest that vegetation be put on the plans, too.
The trees that he recommended be removed?
Typically, we have a lot of vegetation, and some might be tagged as removal or to be preserved. I don't particularly care, but if there's nothing on a plan, there's no way to hold anyone to it.
Seems inconsistent to put something on the plan that you're going to remove, I would think.
Well, we have done it in the past, but whatever's typical procedure.
Okay. I have a couple questions, actually. The trees Mr. Dyer, the policeman, suggested be removed, are those on your property or are those on the town right-of-way?
They're all on the town right-of-way.
Okay. I don't know what we've done in the past, but I don't know that we're in a position to ask an applicant to remove trees that aren't on his property. I have my own personal opinion that if they're in the town right away, then the town should remove them if they wish that they be removed. And I don't know what it is insurance issues and so forth. What happens if we ask an applicant to remove trees that aren't on their own property? You see what I mean? If you look at the plan, there's a setback from what's shown as road edge and the edge of the subdivision. It happens all along Mitchell Road. That there are lots of trees along Mitchell Road, and very few of them are actually on people's properties. But that's just one board member's opinion. That I don't think that I would be in favor of asking the applicant to remove trees that aren't on his own property. I think the issue of the turnaround needs to be clarified on the plan, just so the issue of it evidently is prohibited to be located in the driveways of the properties. I guess I'll look at the board. If there's comment from the fire chief's memo tonight, I don't have it in front of me. I've already lost it. No, I haven't. It's right here. Asking you to keep the access 18 feet wide. The wishes of the board recently have not been to keep public access improved surface is 18 feet wide. Any comment there? What are the wishes of the board? So we can tell the applicant what the board would like to see for road width or driveway width, and if it should change at the end of the right-of-way.
I think that it should be in keeping with what the fire chief is requesting for access. Within reason, and by reason I mean that if you ever intend to pave this, that it's not necessary to pave it 18 feet wide, but to have a 12-foot wide lane, and then beyond that to have the gravel base that the fire chief requires for access, but how that surface, and I believe the fire chief is very amenable to this, is planting some sort of either grass or ground cover along that edge so that it appears 12 feet wide, but the travel way is actually 18. It may help with drainage, particularly with snow events that we have. I think closer to Mitchell Road, it would be important to have that wide enough, particularly where you have a very sharp turning radius, so that a fire truck, I don't know if they'd ever need to make a right turn from Mitchell Road, but I can easily see why the fire chief would want something 18 feet wide. 18 feet to me seems like a reasonable width. Particularly for the paved section. So So what I'm saying is that the paved section should be no less than 18, and that the gravel section can appear to be 12, but the base should actually be whatever the fire chief agrees to, but not less than 12.
So your recommendation, Mr. Emery, is that the, as depicted, 16, the 50 feet from Mitchell Road, the presently depicted paved section, which runs from 16 feet tapering to 12 feet, be 18 feet in its entirety?
Yes, it would need a taper at some point, but it would be 18 feet in its entirety. That the gravel would, the exposed gravel, or the visible gravel area would taper from the 18-foot width down to the 12-foot visible gravel width of the gravel driveway.
Okay, so that 50 feet from Mitchell Road, the pavement will be 18 feet wide?
That's correct.
Okay.
Any other comments in reference to that from the board? I have a question. I don't think that there is any state or municipal plumbing code or anything in our sewer ordinance that says that the applicant can't put the chamber system or the leach field or the septic system closer than 10 feet. Basically, you're proposing chamber systems or high-capacity infiltrators within 10 feet of actually four abutters, properties. Is that by, it looks conspicuously that that's by design. You'd like to push them off into the corners, or is that the only place on those lots that you can find soils suitable for the septic system, chamber systems?
I'll answer that, and if I'm wrong, correct me, but we went to the highest point on each site, and the soils appeared to be pretty uniform throughout these places, and we thought we could get an adequate test pit anywhere. And we just
I just look at it from a good neighbor situation. To shove your leach field, your chamber system, as close to their property doesn't make for good neighbors, I would not think, whether it's the highest point or not. And we're not talking about the taper of the mound, the slight mound system that it is. We're talking from the edge of the way it's drawn anyway, from the last row of chambers or infiltrators to the property line. That's from me to Tom. On two sides, on both septic systems, we've got the leach field sitting that close to the property owners. I, as one board member, I despise seeing that. I just think it's, I know that there's, I don't think that there's any code or any law that says you can't do that. I just think it's not being a good neighbor.
As you may recall at our workshop, I think Mr. Camilla offered that the soils were suitable throughout these proposed building lots, and that the board, however, did want to see full septic designs.
Mm-hmm.
And we have provided those. What I anticipate happening is that new lot owners will relocate those because the soils are suitable everywhere. But I don't intend to relocate them for the purposes of the
review. Well, if they're suitable everywhere, why would you design them in those corners?
Because that's where we chose to dig that day.
I mean,
no particular reason.
Well, there are the test pits on the plan. What did you find there? Test pit 3 and lot 2, for instance.
Years ago?
Is that an old test?
Yes, right. They were all good, I think, years ago.
I've made my comment.
Okay.
Any other comments? Mark, anything?
Yes, I'd have a question about the terms of the transfer of Lot 2 being not part of the public access waiver process. Will that be part of any recorded plan or somehow or other be part of the application?
I intend to record this plan if approval is granted by this board. I will record this plan, the plan as approved.
And will the conditions attached to Lot 2 be recorded along with the plan?
That it's in the deed to Lot 2.
In the deed, okay.
Steve, anything? Okay. It's like we'll be coming back. Do you have questions of the board? As far as coming back one more month, we're going to be scheduling a public hearing. Any questions you have of us? Okay.
No, but if some members of the board have not had the opportunity to visit the site, is it your intention to do so? I think it'd be very enlightening if you did.
Well, next step is to schedule a site visit.
Okay.
It makes it much more convenient if we're all there at once as far
sure.
as making contact and ex parte communications.
I think that the board will see, if it makes a site visit, despite snow cover, it will see that the area where we're concerned about turnaround and access, it's generally flat, generally sound, and it's very easy to create a turnaround or a wider traveled way. It's no difficulty whatsoever to do that.
As far as the turnaround, I think the board, it seems to be the consensus the board would like to see it on the plan itself.
Sure.
When's a good time? Is there any specific time that you can't or can? When's the best for you? We'd like to have it during the daylight hours.
I'm flexible.
Pretty much at this time makes it on a weekend. I only go out when it's above 60 degrees, so.
Well, I'd like it to be not Sunday afternoon.
Okay. I would second that.
A couple of football games on.
How about Saturday morning?
9 o'clock.
I see a shake of the head. I'm trying to think. I have a hockey game in Auburn. Not personally. But.
8 o'clock?
That's fine.
8 o'clock?
Yeah, 9 o'clock's basketball time.
That's right.
Is that this coming Saturday?
We take one step at a time. We got it to Saturday at 8 o'clock. Probably we should have it in the first 2 weeks if there are going to be any changes. This weekend versus next weekend, any
changes? They're predicting a big snowstorm Friday.
Yeah, won't happen.
Yeah, no problem.
We're already full, thanks.
I may not be there then, depending on the roads.
We'll skip the 60-degree criteria. This Saturday?
Saturday.
This Saturday, 8 o'clock?
Yes.
Be there.
If any of you are unable to make it, for whatever reason, and would like to schedule another time, and you would like me there, please call. I will be there.
We will meet. We should pull off from Mitchell Road. Can we pull down the driveway?
Yes, there's adequate.
Adequate width. For
adequate width.
Multiple vehicles in there, I'm sure. Okay. See you at 8 o'clock. Do I have a motion or any further discussion? Digging quickly for the motion, Tom?
Yes, I just want to make sure I have the right motion. Shall I read all the findings of facts to table it?
Mm-hmm.
I move that the application be tabled until the next regular meeting of the Planning Board.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? Unanimous. I'd like to hear another motion, if I could, for a public hearing.
Mr. Chairman, Judy? I move that we hold a public hearing at our next regularly scheduled planning board meeting on this item.
Been moved.
Second.
Been moved and seconded twice. Any further discussion? All those in favor, raise your right hand. Those opposed? Unanimous.
Thank you very much.
Next Saturday, 8 o'clock,
yes.
Following month on the agenda. See you then. Thank you very much. Running slightly behind, the next order of business, the Heath public access waiver request by Ann Heath and Dana Seidlinger for a public access for lot U-42-7 located on Peoples Road. Public access waiver section 19-4-2B. The applicant or a representative of the applicant could come to the podium, please. If you could just introduce yourself and give us a brief summary of what you're proposing for the planning board.
Right. My name's Ann Heath. I'm the daughter of Dana Seidlinger, who owns the land at the moment. I would like to build a log home on the site. The problem is that it's on private. Peoples Cove Road is a private way. Mm-hmm. although it's kept open year-round, it is a private way. I answer any questions anyone has. I don't know that there's anything that isn't in the application that I could add.
Okay. Thank you very much.
There's something was said in the letter that I received from the town, or copy out from the town engineer, about the width of the traveled way, there being a question about the width of the traveled way, that being People's Cove Road.
It may, I don't have that in front of me right now, it may reference your driveway as well, or the access to the site.
That will be directly across from, if you have the site plan in front of you, or directly across from the head of Highview, so it will be accessed from Highview Road. It will never be accessed from anywhere else that I can think of.
Why don't we, at this point, open it up for discussion and the questions, if the board has any questions of the applicant? Tom?
I think the point that the applicant just made is a good one. I'm reasonably familiar with the area, and I think there are probably other board members that are even more familiar than I am. If this were a true public access waiver request, I would think that what we'd be looking for is a 50-foot section of People's Cove Road to be paved out at Ocean House Road. I think, as the applicant has stated, the reality of the situation is that they'll come down Eastfield Road and turn left on a Highview and then proceed across People's Cove Road into what I would call a driveway, park the car and go into the house.
Mm-hmm. That's why we located it at that spot.
The question I would have then, and I'm not as familiar with the area in this respect as some others may be, but my recollection of Highview Road, it could be one of the other ones, but when one gets up there, it's not clear. It seems almost like there's a T turnaround there. Do in fact cars regularly use People's Cove Road to get out to the cove?
You can. The section between Carriage Hill and Highview is becoming somewhat overgrown, and it isn't very pleasant to use. It's usable. We probably will widen that, you know, clear enough so that it is more usable, but it's much more practical to come right up Highview. But it's usable certainly to the extent that anything or anybody or any size vehicle at all could turn around in that spot. The fire chief came up and said, I don't know, said to me that he didn't know that there was too much concern with providing a turnaround because you'd always back into People's Cove Road and turn around. It has become a little bit somewhat overgrown with bushes, but it's certainly travelable.
So I guess the question I would then put to the planner, and I'll answer it while I'm asking it, is that the reason this is a proposed public access access driveway is the fact that People's Cove Road is not a public road, even though there's extensive frontage on it. And therefore, in order to build a house on that, you have to request a public access waiver.
That's right. To get a building permit, you have to have a public access waiver if you're not on a public way.
It would seem to me that the thing that really should be done here is that the end of Highview Road should be made into a T turnaround that would accommodate emergency vehicles, and that there would be nothing that would be necessary other than a normal driveway for your residents. And of the two options, I'm not suggesting that mine is less expensive.
Well, we do have a turnaround planned in that access. The 20-by-30-foot parking area will serve as a turnaround should it be needed.
Mm-hmm. The turnaround that you're talking about for fire vehicles? The issue is that when emergency vehicles get to the end of the road, they have a place to turn around.
Right.
I think what she's referring to is on the site itself, she's got a 20-by-30-foot turnaround. Is that what you're referring to?
Mm-hmm. We were asked to provide that, and it fits in with our plans, my plans anyway, to provide an area for parking cars.
I guess then what I would suggest is that, this is a tough one. I don't feel that you're the only party involved here or should be answering this question, but as far as I can see, for a true public access waiver, and assuming that People's Cove Road is used, that in addition to the turnaround that's typically required on your property would be, as you saw with the last applicant, a 50-foot paved
stretch of road down at Ocean House and Peebles Cove Road, unless it already exists as such.
Looks like a driveway at that end, pretty much.
One of the reasons I asked for a waiver of that requirement is because Peebles Cove Road itself is not paved, but there are winter residents and it's used year-round. And it's plowed year-round.
Again, the situation is, however, for a public access waiver, one of the requirements is that the first 50 feet be paved. You said that it is used during the wintertime.
Yes, it is. There are winter residents down along the shore. Well, there are winter residents along Peebles Cove Road now.
I'm not going to suggest who would pay for it, and I don't think that it's necessarily fair that you should bear the brunt of it. Otherwise, I'd like to see something done here eventually that either connects Carriage Hill and High View and makes this thing into a loop, or gets rid of Peebles Cove. People come down, if it's possible, either come down one of the paved roads. I mean, it's so far out to some of those houses that are located back in there that at some point I think we've got to get a grip on this situation in terms of access. And I'm a little bit surprised that the fire department hasn't...
There is a loop, Tom. If I don't think it'll show on here. Right here, if you look at the end of Eastfield Road, where it starts Private Road, that road will go all the way down to the shore. If you go to the right, it will butt up to Shore Acres, but it's not a through road, but it will turn to the left and turn around and hit
Peebles Cove. Peebles Point Road, that becomes Peebles Point Road.
So there's one large loop.
Yeah. There is an existing loop, right.
And that portion of roadway out there is passable?
It's all passable. Peebles Cove Road's passable, too.
Nothing we have shows that.
Well, I guess in that case, I think that the first 50 feet of Peebles Cove Road should be paved, and I don't see any need whatsoever for a fire truck turnaround on your property. I mean, I don't see how your house in this condition is any different than the other single-family house located on any street in town, and none of which I understand has to have room for a fire truck to turn around, but which on arterial streets does have to have a turnaround for vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
And
there are several houses on Peebles Cove Road that are not, that don't even have, there's two that don't even have driveway, but they have places to turn around, mm-hmm. and nothing is paved because the road itself isn't paved.
Yeah, we have in the past waived the requirement for mm-hmm. paving. I think that would be appropriate to do in this situation.
One of the aspects about the approach to this parcel is that the approach really is from Eastfield and Carriage Hill and Highview, or the Carriage Hill is a dead end that's 250 feet long, perhaps, 300 feet long, and all access, and the Peebles Cove Road is not completely passable in the winter, at any rate, in between Carriage Hill and Highview, because there's no need for it to be. In the summer, it's accessible year-round, you know, for the full length of the road. So improvements to Peebles Cove, where it meets Old Ocean House, really don't relate to the actual use pattern.
Don't need to.
That's involved in getting to any of these lots, because Carriage Hill is a relatively short dead end.
Would it resolve the issue if the fire chief would give comment or approval to emergency vehicle turnaround I can't do it in the private way.
I guess the other, not to interrupt, Mr. Chairman, but I guess the other issue, and it just occurs to me here, is I look at this site, and I don't mean to pick on this applicant, but the reality of the situation is this applicant has, I don't know how many square feet this is, but in significant frontage along Peebles Cove Road, and at some point it would seem, I feel that Carriage Road High View Road, in this case would work very well if the ends were linked together, so an additional loop was created there to provide access to this frontage.
Well, so, I think in the application, it indicates, and correct me if I'm wrong, Mrs. Heath, that the location of the house is where it is because it is approximately at, right at, the driveway begins at the end of Highview Road.
That was why we located the driveway there, not specifically the house.
Okay.
Peoples Cove Road is, it's not any less accessible than it ever was, it's just that the bushes have, you know, the road itself is passable, but the bushes have tended to grow over because people don't use it much, they don't need to. But no significant improvements would be needed on the road, just have to trim some bushes back, which I think will probably happen during the construction process anyway.
Other comment, Judy?
Having said what I did on the last application about public access waivers, to me, this is one that I wish didn't even have to come before the board. It's a lot of record. We're not asked to create a lot. It's on an existing historic road. Granted, it's a small one. It just happens to be private. And they're such worlds apart to me, Mr. Drynan's application and this one. My only question had been is that there was some request or requirement proposed that some vegetation be cleared, and I was somewhat hesitant about that requirement. I didn't know, Mrs. Heath, if the vegetation that was proposed to be removed is on your land?
It's bushes that are growing up over the section of Peoples Cove Road between Carriage Hill and Highview because it isn't used much.
So it is in that right of way?
It's brush, but it's not growing in the roadway. It's just kind of canopying up over it so you get your car scratched if you, mm. You know, all it would require is some clearing of that, not anything done to the road itself.
I wasn't even aware that the site distance requirement was required for the private road.
Wasn't either.
Why would it be for a private road or even the same would apply for paper street whether it's improved or not? It's private property. We're asking for site distance down a private piece of private property.
I'd prefer not to do that.
I would think that the only thing that you're looking for would be the site distance down Highview Road. And it's a straight shot down Highview Road. Maybe I'm wrong on that.
The way I've already always read it, Mr. Chairman, is the site distance issue applies. And again, I think it's unusual the way the diagram is drawn here because the site distance would apply at the intersection of Ocean House Road and Peoples Cove Road. Because what we really have here, as Judy said, we have an existing, we have a lot of record, and really what we're talking about is a driveway.
I think they're asking for the public access across, from the end of Highview Road, across a private road onto their site. So the public access is across the, I'm not sure what the width of that right-of-way of Peoples Cove Road is, but it appears to be approximately 40 feet, 50 feet.
It's 40 feet.
It's 40 feet. So the question seems to be, does this board want to require the paving of the first 50 feet of that from the end of Highview Road, or is that something reasonable to waive? There are a lot of different issues why we've waived that requirement and why we haven't, or why we've required it. Sometimes it's simply a matter of practicality when there's wash from a gravel road onto a public street that from a public works situation that causes problems and there's always stone washing out onto the road. Tom, you look like you have
something. Yeah, I guess I'm being particularly retentive on this. I'm not sure why it is. I guess what troubles me here is that we have a private road. Is the private road maintained by the town?
No, it's maintained by an association of residents.
By the association, okay.
But the sewer pumping station is down on the shorefront and a lot of winter residents, so it is maintained very regularly and plowed.
I guess what's troubling me then is that we have a private road that's not well maintained, that doesn't have the typical public access paved first 50 feet. And I'm as much in favor of rural roads in this town as anyone. And at the convenience of the people who live on the private road, they use the public road for their primary access. Maybe that's just a gripe I have. I guess that's my problem. But that to me does not seem equitable.
I think the other, given as an example, whatever lot lies, I'm looking at the tax map, closer to the shore down Peoples Cove Road, would be on sheet R3. If that lot were looking for a building permit, where would their, I would guess that they would request the same public access waiver from the end of Highview Road. I don't know how the road's patterned down a little further, but...
That house has been there long before, since long before the requirement existed, I think, but the one on the other side of the road is Bruce Glazier's house. That doesn't show probably on, it doesn't show on my site, but it's almost across from that property you're talking about, and that was built just a few years ago, and it didn't require that he pave in front of the house. The whole road was a dirt road, still is.
Any further discussion? Mark? All set. Stephen?
Just one question. I'm sorry to interrupt. Did we resolve the issue of the site distance?
No.
Maureen, do you have a comment?
Can we resolve that with a motion?
We do intend to clear that brush so that there will be a clear site.
I guess what I'd like to resolve, if it's not necessary and it's going to destroy the character of the road, I would prefer not to have it done.
It's just trimming them away from where they start to come over the road, not clearing at the ground level.
Yes.
I've been down this road with the code enforcement officer, and I made sure he took his vehicle. I believe that if they trim the brush, there'll still be a lot of brush there.
Okay.
Does the board have the letter that I got a copy of from the town engineer?
Yes.
Yes.
Recommending, you know, the waivers that I asked for?
Yes, we do.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I would like to propose a motion.
Thank you.
Findings of fact, one, Ann Heath and Dana Seidlinger are requesting a public access waiver for lot U-42-7 located on Peoples Cove Road. Two, the requirement for adequate site distance can be met with clearing of existing vegetation. Three, the plan substantially complies with section 19-4-2B of the zoning ordinance. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Ann Heath and Dana Seidlinger for a public access waiver for lot U-42-7 located on Peoples Cove Road be granted subject to the following condition. One, that the clearing along Peoples Cove Road be done to achieve a minimum site distance of 250 feet.
Can I ask one last question?
I'd like to have a second first, if I could.
Well,
then move.
That's why I wanted to ask the question before I second.
We go to discussion after the second.
Okay,
move.
Second.
Moved and second, and now discussion.
Is the applicant's wish to clear the brush along the side of the road? If you had your choice, would you rather not do that?
I'd like to leave it as natural as possible, only to clear what's growing up overhead so it doesn't scratch vehicles, and I think that will satisfy the requirement.
You agree with that, Maureen? Okay.
I guess the question I would have, and I wasn't following, I was looking forward. Does the motion as read resolve the issue of any waiver of the first 50 feet?
Aren't they typically implied if we don't require it?
Okay, because the waiver is requested, we don't have to include that in the motion?
Because she's not depicting any pavement on the plans.
Okay.
When you approve the plans and it doesn't show that pavement, then it's implied that you waived it.
Yes, a couple issues of discussion. This is similar to the prior agenda item. Is there wishes of the board to have a site walk, a public hearing?
No.
Thought I should just ask. Any other discussion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Don.
Just trying to get to the root of my discomfort here. I guess the root of it is this. Of course, we have a chicken and the egg situation. These lots may have long preceded and existed before the Eastfield Road subdivision was created. I don't know. And parties involved with one may have sold land and developed the other. I just have no idea. I guess the concern that I have is that we have an existing gravel private road whose residents primarily use, or at least this applicant intends to use, the paved public road. So what we're creating here, although there was a pre-existing lot, was not a pre-existing house, we're creating additional traffic, albeit perhaps not, at least in today's sense, that much traffic, but we're creating additional traffic that's being put down a paved public street rather than utilizing the gravel access route, the private gravel access route upon which it has frontage. That's what troubles me. It seems only appropriate that people who are living on a private road, have frontage on the private road, would make use of that private road and be, and when I say the people who live on it, I'm not just using the applicant for an example. I think the homeowners association, whatever association is responsible for maintaining the private road, would maintain it to a level that it would remain passable.
I understand your point. I think the applicant wishes to use only 50 feet of that right-of-way versus 600 feet of it to access their own lot. See what I'm saying?
No.
Instead of accessing a lot from People's Cove Road, from Old Ocean House Road, to the distance of 600 or 700 feet, their wish is to access their lot, crossing about 50 feet of a private right-of-way.
My point is that the applicant has probably 700 feet of frontage on a private way, which other residents have private frontage on. Mm-hmm. It would seem appropriate to me, since we're granting a public access waiver for a lot that is not located on a public way, that the private way be maintained appropriately so that access not only to this lot but to other lots closer to the ocean could be gained over People's Cove Road rather than through existing neighborhoods.
I understand your point, but I guess I would just be in disagreement that's the rights of the owners of that road. You're asking that they not use the public road, and they're taxpayers like the rest of us.
No, I'm not asking that they not use it. I'm just asking that the private road upon which they have frontage be maintained appropriately.
Again, that's an issue of private ownership of the road.
No, I think it's also an issue of public safety. Just as Ed Reinen has a lot that's set way back from the road, that in order to have fire vehicles have safe and appropriate access to not only, again, I'm sorry to drag your application into this, but there are other properties on this road, that the road should be maintained appropriately so that fire access can be maintained over the public road, over the private road.
Maureen?
Not that this will help any. I have had several people come into my office from this neighborhood. Their major concern has not been that someone's building a house, but the condition of the road. I think this is just a good example of a very, an area that's been developed a long time ago. And we're still living with some of the, maybe the lack of farsightedness that we hopefully are exercising today when we approve accesses. But this, I'm not sure that, I've talked to some of the people that don't even know what the width of their right-of-way is. It's a very old situation, and I think it needs more than just, unless the town wants to go in there with a lot of money. It's something that I think the owners in the area are going to have to try to resolve.
I don't know if Mrs. Heath would know this or you, Maureen. Isn't there a large amount of that land down there owned by a single person or family, and a lot of those homes are leased when you
get... Yes, it's all part of you're in our family members.
Because I could see one day in the future development being possible down there, Tom, and I think it'd be extremely appropriate at that time to look at that secondary access so you would have two means of access. I don't know the situation, but there is a potential...
Well, that section between Carriage Hill Road and People's Court and Highview Road, I think the reason that it has become somewhat overgrown is because the public ways are there and they're easier for the people down at the waterfront to use. There's no reason not to use the public ways. Mm-hmm. And nobody actually has a driveway off that section of Peebles Cove Road. Nobody has frontage. I mean, they have sidage, if you will, but their driveways all are on the public.
Ocean House Road.
So there's no reason for anyone to have used it.
And Lot 6 is accessed via Ocean House Road?
The lots off of Carriage Hill and off of Highview all have driveways off those roads. They have the sides of their properties about on Peebles Cove Road, but they have no reason whatever to use that section of Peebles Cove Road since there have been.
I think that one does.
There are two lots closer to Ocean House Road on Peebles Cove Road.
Those do use Peebles Cove Road, and it's well-maintained, and it's not a very large section of road, and there's no reason it could not be improved either by my family or probably even by the builder when he comes in with his machinery, will probably level it off a little bit.
I guess my point is that if we would like to see improved access here, and again, I don't care if it's 10 feet wide, it doesn't have to be a boulevard, but if we want to see improved access along this private road for emergency purposes, I think this applicant holds the key to that, being the last parcel along this frontage that's not that well-maintained. Because there's no reason that anyone, as she has said, anyone along either Highview Road or Carriage Hill Road, whose properties don't front Peebles Cove Road, would be interested in improving Peebles Cove Road.
I certainly understand your point, I just, I'm not in agreement that, you know, the burden of the application is to improve Peebles Cove Road to any extent.
I just think that the board, or at least insofar the deliberations indicate that the board is being very inconsistent with, and again, you're caught in the middle of this, and I'm not picking on you personally, where we have some people who have reasonable access off a very well-maintained road, albeit it's several hundreds of feet dead end, where we have here, I think, potentially, from a functional standpoint, a dead-end situation. Because the only real emergency access beyond this Highview Road is through Eastfield Road. And I don't see why we're not in a similar dead-end situation here that we weren't in the other applications.
Ms. Murray, I understand your concern. That's why I wish that this application was not at all classified the same way as Mr. Drynan's, because to me, that's a subdivision, and I would feel very comfortable requiring improvements of someone like Mr. Drynan. One assumes there's a potential for making money since he's talking about sale of lots. And the way I see this is this woman is fortunate or unfortunate enough to own a nice piece of land, which happens to be separated from a public road by like 40 feet of land that she has rights to. If she were doing a subdivision, I might be the first one to agree that that part of Peebles Cove Road should be improved. In this case, I don't like the thought of requiring it of her, and I agree that's inconsistent, and I don't know what we can do about that.
I tell you, what you're looking to do is ask the applicant to change their application to indicate to this board that they want their access over Peebles Cove Road?
No, I'm not asking for that at all. I really don't care whether they use Highview Road or Carriage Hill Road or Peebles Cove Road. I guess what I'm concerned about is we have a private road that is used, again, by a major landholder for leased lots, and a good portion of that traffic ends up on Eastfield Road because Peebles Cove Road is not maintained. Or at least in my estimation, that's the situation.
That's been the situation for quite a while.
Mm-hmm.
It's my hope and intent that that road never become not passable. I'd like to maintain at least well enough to be able to be used, if not the preferable way.
Mr. Seidlinger?
Could I have permission to come in on the conversation, too?
Certainly.
Yeah.
You're Mr. Seidlinger?
I'm Mr. Seidlinger, yes. Yeah. Now, on that Peebles Cove Road, as it goes down to the ocean, there are, I don't know how many families, but there are quite a few, probably 25 or 30 or more cottages down there who have been using that road for years.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess you know, I don't think we should say perhaps that it isn't well-maintained. It's kept plowed, and it's kept reasonably smooth. Now, that's from, and that land down there is all owned by one person. All those cottages are on leased land down there. And it seems to me that the suggestion did come up that if there's going to come a time when there will be, those people will either own the cottages or it'll become, they will take over the land one way or another. And at that time, probably, they will want the town to take it over or have a paved road down there. But it's not clear to me exactly what you would like to have us do. Would you like to have the road paved from Ocean House Road?
No, not at all. No, not at all. I'm not asking you to do that whatsoever.
You want 50 feet of paved road?
No, I'm not saying that whatsoever. It's to one extent almost hypothetical. My point is this, is that there's People's Cove Road is an existing gravel road.
It's a private, existing...
It's a private road.
However...
What concerns me is that there's a public road adjacent to it upon which everyone, many of the people who would otherwise use People Cove Road, go through other people's neighborhood, put increased traffic into essentially what's a side street in order to gain access. They have the good fortune that the town has paved or has maintained this road at a higher level than People's Cove Road. What I'm saying is that we have an application before us, which is probably the last chance, unless all of this land goes into a subdivision, to ask for any improved improvements to People's Cove Road. My request is as simple as this. All I need is a letter from the fire chief stating that he does not require any improvements to People's Cove Road and that he feels satisfied with the emergency access to the properties closer to the ocean, as well as the ones, the property before us.
That should have come out of the letter. He came down, looked at it, and he said, I don't see a problem. If anyone asks me, I will tell them I don't see a problem. Apparently no one's asked him. I thought that's why we had the grace period, the 3-week lead time, so that those questions could come up. But he's perfectly willing to confirm that he has no problem. At least that's what he stated. He came down, looked at it. Because I had built in this turnaround to make sure that there was access, and he said, I don't even know why you need that. Why can't we just back into People's Cove Road to turn around?
Maureen assures me that the chief will write it. We quite often ask for the letter to be in writing from the chief, and we don't have the same 3-week lead time on the documents that we see. But I think... There's
another point that may be of interest to Mr. Emery there. Mrs. Tucker, who owns all that land, in an attempt to avoid some traffic going down there, did put another road through from the, what is the name of the road that comes in off of Ocean?
Eastfield.
The end of East Road.
That goes down into People's Cove and has taken a lot of that traffic away. It doesn't seem to me that my daughter with one single home there is going to add a great deal of a problem with traffic going up that
High View
Road there.
Mr. Chairman?
I want it to be very clear that I understand that she won't. She's caught in the middle of this. Unfortunately, it's always the way it works. The last person in is the one that gets burdened with all of the ills that came before. Or the lack of planning that came before. I would just like to, the letter from the fire chief is fine. Along with that, I'd like a clear understanding as to whether or not there's a turnaround required on her lot. I don't believe there should be. And if at all possible, I hate to see that you have to invest in a retaining wall. If you could make this thing work without building a retaining wall, I'd be happy to see that as well. That to me is...
Well, the purpose for that, if you could see the land, is that it slopes down, and we don't want to create any problems with drainage onto People's Cove Road, so that it's designed to slope just slightly, as opposed to it's going to be built up, but not so far as to drain onto People's Cove. A retaining wall is necessary for me to create a parking area, whether or not it was a turnaround.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman?
Judy?
I'd like to amend my motion, if I may, and add a second condition of approval. What I would propose is that, for number two, that prior to issuance of a building permit, the fire chief submit for the record a letter indicating that emergency access to the property is adequate.
Is that acceptable to the secondee?
Yes, I will second as amended.
Very good. Any further discussion?
I hope that that letter, as it would with many other applications, passes the flaming oil truck in the road test. That is, if Eastfield Road, for any reason, is blocked off, that People's Cove Road has adequate access for all of the development on People's Cove Road down to the ocean. And again, this is not to pick on you. You just happen to be the last person in. It's a matter of public safety that I'm raising here, nothing else. And I'm hopeful that the letter will more than be enough to cover it.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read and amended, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's the unanimous vote. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there anything more I have to do, or do I await you?
You should contact the police, the fire chief, and request a letter from him stating that his acceptance of that, acceptable turnaround for fire and safety reasons, and either have him deliver to Maureen O'Meara, or you can bring that letter to her. Thank you very much. I'm sorry we're running behind schedule.
Good evening.
Good evening. I do need to, if I can find my agenda, I need to read down through the agenda items. Ledgemere Daycare site plan request by William and Joni Hewitt for site plan review of an addition of the Ledgemere Country Day School located at 243 Mitchell Road, site plan completeness, section 19-2-10. The applicant's already to the podium. If you could introduce yourself and
My name is Bill Hewitt. This is my wife, Joni, and our building contractor, Larry Light. We are here tonight to seek approval to move an existing office that we currently house in our house as an addition to the nursery school. And the addition is a two-story, 240 square foot, it's a 10-by-12 addition. This addition will not add any increase in the current enrollment that we have at the school. The school is licensed for up to 30 children at one time on site. Do I need to, at this time, I'd like to comment on the incomplete items.
Okay, what I prefer to do, typically what we do is Maureen, our planner, walks down through those issues. The first order of business is, of course, determination and completeness. She'll review those with us, and then your comments would be certainly welcome.
Thank you.
Maureen?
Board members may want to refer to attachment one, which is the fourth page down, which is the summary checklist for site plan review. I'm going to go down to item 6D, those parking areas. I don't know if there are any questions up until that point.
Again, if I can just interrupt, I think it works best if you interrupt Maureen, after she finishes an item, we can stop and discuss an item at that point instead of going all the way through and then trying to come back. Thanks.
6D, the proposed plan doesn't indicate the number of parking spaces or a parking area. However, it does appear that there seems to be areas on the site for parking along existing paved drives. Moving down to 10, unless there are questions. Again, it's the same item. No proposed parking areas are depicted. Continue to move down to item 14. The applicant has requested several waivers. This particular waiver, I believe, relates to lighting. There is any additional lighting proposed by the applicant. I did have an abutter come in and ask me, however, what the proposed lighting was going to be, and also didn't have any problem at all with what the applicant was requesting in terms of development. but was hoping that maybe there might be some reduction of lighting on the site, at least in terms of focusing lighting more directly on the site and less spillage onto abutting properties, and if possible, even some reduction of lighting. And so that particular abutter had no desire for any kind of a public hearing, but just wanted the issue raised and perhaps discussed. Unless there are any further questions, moving down to item 16, which is evidence of right title interest. Typically, the board has a demonstration of right title interest by having a survey submitted, which is stamped by a registered surveyor. Survey has been submitted, but it doesn't have a survey. It doesn't have a stamp on it. The other concern is that the key map that's submitted by the applicant shows the lot having a different configuration with frontage on another street. So there's a little bit of question exactly what the boundaries of the property are. Are there any questions?
Don't appear to be any questions. If you'd care to respond briefly to each one of those, if you want.
The first item 60 that talks about the proposed parking. Presently, our driveway / parking area is used for the dropping off of children at the front of our home and for on-site parking of the teachers. So at this point, there is no additional spaces needed. There are no additional spaces that have to be carved out on our property because we have no increased enrollment. Number 10, again, no proposed parking areas. Number 14, regarding the lighting, since my wife and I have owned the property since July of 1988, we have not added any lighting to the nursery school. So the question has been risen by Maureen about toning down lights. So if the board could be specific in helping us comply with this request. Number 16, note on the site plan indicates that a survey has been done, and we had a site plan done prior to us buying the property, April of 1988. We used the draftsman to update the current site plan. I have the original site plan done in 1988. If you'd would like, I could submit that as part of the request. The key map submitted shows different property boundaries. Mr. Leiden developed Mantra Woods right behind us, and some of the lot lines on the key map are currently not there. I mean, I'm just going to use the reference that these are old lot lines where some of these lots were joined together to form an existing lot.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Any comments, questions, concerns? Stephen?
I guess the one issue that seems to have been brought up is lighting. I have absolutely no understanding what's there now, so could you fill us in on what is there?
Right. We currently have, we have three entrances to the nursery school, and on two of them we have a light, like you're on your porch, a porch light, and then we have a floodlight that's on the end of our home that faces a park, not our home, the school, that faces a parking area. And that, in checking out, doesn't shine on any abutter's property.
So that shines toward the existing paved drive?
Right. Now, if a lower wattage bulb needs to be used, I can certainly accommodate that. And on the addition, next to the door, we did plan to put a night light, but if the board requests that no light be used, the addition faces our home and does not face the abutters.
I think looking at the side elevations, was the front elevation Shows just a small, I think that's a small light beside the door.
Right.
Okay, and that's the side that faces the structure, which is your house.
Right.
Shows nothing on the 12-foot side, the side elevation.
Right.
Shows four windows.
No lights, and that faces directly into the playground.
The playground area, okay. And you're not proposing any lighting on that?
On that side, no.
None at all?
We do not have any children past 5:00 there.
I guess the, and I'm usual, as usual, I am the guilty one of proceeding towards some technical merit issues. Reminder, we were discussing completeness. Sometimes we wander off and start discussing issues of the application itself. The first requirements, whether we deem this complete or incomplete, just like comments from the board, and we can proceed. Judy?
Mr. Chairman, I feel comfortable with the parking areas being included as the existing paved drive, which is shown on the plan, since the school has been in operation for many years, and I don't know how long the configuration has been that way, but I assume it works. With respect to the lighting, if the only new light proposed right now is the door light, and since it is shown on the plan, although not labeled, I feel that's adequate for completion, completeness.
Any other issues of completeness? If none, do we have a motion?
I'll make a motion. Motion with the planning board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of William and Joni Hewitt for the site plan review of a 240-square-foot office/storage addition to the Ledgemere Country Day School located at 243 Mitchell Road be deemed complete.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as made, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a unanimous vote. Deemed it complete. Now the option of the board is to proceed from this point. We have a number of different options. We can decide whether we want site walk, public hearing, or whether we just simply discuss further, give direction to the applicant, take action tonight. What's the wishes of the board?
I, for one, would like to take action tonight.
Anybody else?
I agree.
Let me just confer with Maureen. We're well within realms of procedure for site plan review. Seems to be the consensus of the board not to opt for a public hearing. Is there any further discussion? Questions, Tom?
Yes, I do have a question. I haven't built any additions in Cape Elizabeth myself, but my recollection of the ordinance is there's some unusual, we have an unusual ordinance from the standpoint that I believe we measure to the foundation of a building. So people started putting additions on sonotubes, thinking that they would get by the setback requirements by measuring again to the foundation rather than to the projection that was sitting on sonotubes. And rather than change the language to state that setbacks would be measured to the nearest point of the building, the ordinance was changed to state that any addition had to have a frost wall or full basement located beneath it. I would just like clarification as a condition of the building permit that the plans show sonotube, that if a frost wall or other foundation system is required, that it be so duly noted and approved by the code enforcement officer.
I think Maureen is referencing that.
I think that old setback definition was changed with the shoreline zoning.
With the shoreline zoning.
With the shoreline zoning amendments to keep it consistent with the state. And I do remember there was an interesting wrinkle with that. But the current setback definition is the shortest distance from a building to the nearest lot line or sideline of a street right-of-way.
You're saying, Tom, that the prior...
It was my understanding that all additions had to be placed, had to have a frost wall foundation. And I'm not aware that Ernie dropped that requirement because of shoreline zoning. I know.
Yeah, and I wouldn't know anything about that, yeah. I just wanted to let you know, but, I mean, there's nothing in the setbacks that would require that.
Where else would we find that, if we could find it?
That would probably be a building code item, which could be part of the BOKA code or somewhere buried in zoning ordinance.
Not necessarily purview of the planning board, anyway.
Exactly, okay. Just happened to notice it, and when people point out sonotube additions and setback variations, I always like to have an answer.
Very good. Anything else?
I have a question about the walkway.
Yes.
That was raised. Does the door out of the office, is that intended to be a means of egress or a,
no,
or a used, or is that just,
just
for emergency, or...
Right, it just enters into the playground.
Okay.
It's just another access in case of emergency purposes.
So there will be no walkway?
Right.
Right. And I noticed that you have a step drawn there, you're going to have a stoop or something where you can step down onto the ground.
Yes, because it was going to be built on 2x12. It's going to be 2x12 construction for the base.
Anything further? Judy?
I guess I have a question. We have a proposed motion for approval. And one of the proposed conditions is that erosion control measures be incorporated into the plan, which also separate children in the playground from the construction area. Are you familiar with what that means?
Yes, Mr. Leiden filled me in earlier on proper setup with hay bales and fencing, some kind of fencing off to make sure that we comply with safety.
And do you feel comfortable with the condition as written that code enforcement officer, whomever is looking at this, that it's clear what's intended?
My intent would be to make sure that all of the other conditions are met through condition number 4, which means that prior to any issuance of a building permit, a plan would be submitted that would show what the erosion control measures would be for the site during construction, so that somehow on the plan there would be either detail of hay bales or a line of where the silt fencing was going to be installed or something at the applicant's choice.
And what Mr. Hewitt said, you assume that either yourself or Ernie would find that adequate to meet that condition?
Yes.
Some hay bales and some sort of fence?
I would find it adequate.
Okay. And Mr. Hewitt, you did indicate you are willing to reduce the wattage. Is it of the floodlight that concerns the neighbor, Maureen? Do you know?
The neighbor didn't mention a specific light. There was some concern about, I guess there wasn't a specific comment about light actually flooding the neighboring property. It just there was a lot of generation of light. If you wanted to go out and look at the stars, it was getting more difficult to see them, those kind of issues.
I think one of the problems with the site, and it's not actually a problem with the site, is that that structure sits up higher than almost all. It sits on top of a knoll, and it's normally all the surrounding homes and so forth are going to get more exposure to the lighting from that, whether it's a porch light or whatever, it's just going to shine down. It's just a little more difficult, I think. And I don't know, there doesn't seem to be any proposed new lighting, or the only one that is on the 10-foot side that faces to the home. And that's typically a 75-watt light bulb.
Is there any feeling on the board if anyone would want to have that floodlight reduced?
I will do that as goodwill, since I have lived next to the same neighbors for the last 5-6 years, and we all are very friendly, so since whoever has a concern, I will gladly do that this weekend. Can I ask a question? I'm still unclear of the plan I have to submit on the construction showing the hay bales. Can this be a handwritten on a piece of loose leaf, or does this have require that?
Probably the easiest thing for you to do would be to take the site plan that you have,
okay,
and detail where you're going to put the erosion control, and then say what it's going to be. Is it going to be silt fencing? Is it going to be hay bales? you know, just a short paragraph that describes what you're going to put in, and then the location on the plan.
Okay.
Is that something that you can address, though?
It's something that should be put on the plan, and if it's made a condition of planning board approval, I'll be checking it.
May want to check with the town code enforcement officer before you put something in the detail to the plan, make sure that that's what he's looking for. Tom?
Mr. Chairman, I guess I would have a concern about the safety of the children and their proximity to the construction site with respect to erosion control, and I don't want to be struck by lightning by saying this. It would be my best opinion that on a 10 by 12 addition, which is about the size of a quarter of a garage, that the impact on the environment would be greater through the manufacture of the silt fence, and it would be a benefit to any translocation of silt on the site. The project is so small that I think that it would be completed so soon that erosion control, is indeed on our checklist, and it has to be addressed. I see this as, unless you have anticipate having a pile of earth beside the building for an extensive period of time that would erode down into your neighbor's yard, I would see that as an issue. But I see this as so small, there are just so many cases where I see miles and miles of erosion control fabric upslope from places they're just put in as a matter of course, and I would really ask the board to focus on the size of this project and really consider if erosion control is necessary at all.
But I tell you, you do feel that the separation of the children from construction is important, so
I don't,
perhaps maybe it's more of a safety fence or safety containment.
And I would leave that up to the applicant and the code enforcement officer. I don't want to be into methods and means here, become a third party.
Perhaps proposing, and if we have a proposed condition that the erosion control / safety fence. I would certainly hope to see it more of a safety fence to keep children away from that site. And as Tom says, with silt fences of 18 inches or 24 inches high, not exactly a safety fence. Any discussion? Motion? Judy?
I'll try one. Here's a motion for the board to consider. Findings of facts. 1. William and Joni Hewitt are requesting site plan review of a 240-square-foot office storage addition to the Ledgemere Country Day School located at 243 Mitchell Road. 2. The plan was deemed complete at the January 18, 1994 meeting of the Planning Board. 3. Additional information on the potential construction of a walkway, installation of lighting, and erosion control is needed to assure construction on the site is consistent with the approved plan. 4. The application substantially complies with the requirements of Section 19-2-10 site plan regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of William and Joni Hewitt for site plan review of a 240-square-foot office storage addition to the Ledgemere Country Day School located at 243 Mitchell Road be granted, subject to the following conditions. 1. That any new walkway to the addition be depicted on the plan and reviewed by the town planner. Actually, I'm going to strike that. The applicant has indicated there will not be one. Excuse me. 1. That no additional lighting, with the exception of an exterior door light, be added to the site until the applicant prepares a lighting plan for planning board review. 2. That the applicant reduce the wattage of the existing floodlight. 3. That appropriate erosion control measures be incorporated into the plan, period. 4. That an adequate barrier be installed to separate children from the construction area. 5. That the plans be revised to reflect the above conditions and submitted to the town planner prior to the issuance of a building permit.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there further discussion?
How do we deal with my question? Is that simply between the applicant and the code enforcement officer?
As far as
foundations?
The foundation system. It would be.
Okay.
The other alternative is inert as a condition. It's not within our purview, really, to control it, I think. question that I have is, Judy, would you want to strike in the findings of fact, additional, under number three, additional information on potential and strike construction of a walkway?
Yes.
And just go to potential installation of lighting?
Okay.
Okay, since we're striking it below.
Could you please, excuse me, could you please repeat number five? I didn't get that.
I believe it's hard on my notes to read which came first. One was additional lighting. Two was reducing the floodlight. Three was appropriate erosion control measures, I believe. Four was an adequate barrier for safety, I believe. And five was the final one as written on the memo that the plans be revised to reflect the above conditions and submitted to the town planner prior to the issuance of a building permit.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
If passed, you'll get a copy of those conditions anyway. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read and amended, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a unanimous vote. Thank you very much, and good luck.
Thank you.
That was the last order of new business. There is no old business. Is there other business? As a matter of record, under other business, I will mention that, and I don't know if all planning board members received a copy of the resignation letter from Bob Martin.
No.
Bob Martin has decided to resign from the board for a couple of different reasons. He didn't foresee any immediate opportunity to come onto the board as a full voting member. But he did have an interesting comment in the letter, and I think I'll try to make the letter available. Do you have a copy, Maureen? Did I ask you? I guess it was a letter to myself and to Deborah Lane. He made a comment in his resignation letter that he thought it might be appropriate or more advantageous if this were to become a planning board of seven voting members instead of five voting members and two associate members. And after thinking about it, it to a certain extent, it makes some sense. The council has no training period for its council members. This is a process that takes some getting up to speed time in the planning process. But we do have a town planner who could take a candidate through a couple training sessions. Everybody starts sometime. There's nothing to say that an associate member in the first evening is not requested or asked if they care to vote on an agenda item. You can start your second of the month as a regular voting member on any agenda item that night. I just thought, and maybe that's something we might bring up at the committee meeting for review if discussion.
The irony of it is I'm not even convinced that the waiting period has anything to do with a learning process, in that one can be a non-voting member of the board, associate member of the board, for a year and still not be a regular voting member, and a regular member of the board can resign and be replaced, and the person that replaces the regular member automatically is a voting member, mm-hmm. rather than going to the bottom of the line, so to speak, or the back of the line and working their way forward.
I understand, and I don't know I historically how this process of having five board members and two associate members.
I assumed it was an initiation process, nothing more, nothing less.
Okay. It's just something of interest, and I thought his comment was well taken. I'll provide the board members with a copy of that. I'll miss Bob Martin. I think he's the potential of being a very good board member. Certainly came to the board with an interesting background, oftentimes being on the other side of the podium as an applicant, I think, in the commercial real estate business. Maureen?
The board, I believe, received a letter from the town manager noting that the council has changed the expiration times for board members to January at the beginning of the year. That's going to require some changes to the planning board rules and regulations, because it talks about electing your officers in March of every year. So by the end of this year, the board may want to update its regulations. You may at that time also want to use that as a vehicle to suggest to the council that they consider discontinuing the associate member status and going with seven full members.
One other reason I would support that is, it's my understanding there's no limit on the number of terms an associate member can serve, that there's a limit on these members. And just by virtue that I was appointed an associate member, I can serve on the board longer than Mr. Parkhurst, even though we've been here relatively the same amount of time. Doesn't seem to make sense to me why that would be the case.
Just, I don't want to prolong the meeting. I had an objective to get out of here by 9 o'clock tonight and came close. A short period of time ago, we changed the term from 5 years to 3 years, and the reason for changing, one of the reasons, a major reason for changing from a five-year term to a three-year term is in the 1980s, the planning board members seemed to drop like flies after considerable burnout after 3-4 years, and almost never would they re-up for a second term. What's the consensus or any feedback from the board as to the length of a three-year, two-three-year terms being a limit of a planning board member?
I think regardless of the workload, 5 years sounds like you had it for a medical degree. 3 years maybe we want to, if one could serve two consecutive five-year terms, can we serve three consecutive three-year terms? Would be an appropriate way of dealing with it.
Interesting point, as far as total number of years. Mm-hmm. That portion was not changed.
Because right now we serve 6 years at the most.
Limited to 6 years, right?
Or isn't it two full terms?
That's true.
Because you can fill in, like I came in to fill in.
Not as an associate member, right.
I see what you mean. As a full member, yeah. It's two full terms.
That's true,
but
you can serve.
Okay. Sorry, any other business? Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Opposed?
Good evening. Thank you very much.
Oh, thanks.
If I insist.
The Department of Mental Health is responsible for the delivery.